Hi guys, welcome back to another edition of the Learning Glass Lectures on Physics. We're continuing our discussion here. We're going to talk about more of the fundamentals of physics. And we are talking about electricity and magnetism, this term. So this is very important stuff. It helps us understand the universe around us. It governs a lot of the behavior of you and me and what happens in chemistry and what happens in biology. And it's a really fascinating topic. Let's just back up for a second and let's talk a little bit about the four particles that we had mentioned earlier and the four forces that we need to be worried about. So there are four particles at normal everyday energies. When you get to high energy physics, you can add some more particles into the mix, but there's four that we need to worry about here in our local environment. One, of course, is the electron. The second is the up quark. The third is the down quark. And the fourth is the neutrino. Okay, these are the four basic particles that you need to worry about. Now, electrons you're familiar with. Everybody's heard of electrons. The rest, maybe you're not so familiar with. But you kind of are, because it turns out the up quark and the down quark go into the proton, but they also go into the neutron. A proton is two up quarks and one down quark. A neutron is two down quarks and one up quark. Okay, so protons and neutrons are in fact made up of quarks. And then the last guy on the list is the neutrino, the little neutron. And the neutrino is zero charge, nearly zero mass, zips around the universe at the speed of light, goes through almost everything without leaving a trace, very hard to detect. It was predicted theoretically and then verified experimentally. Okay, so those are the four particles that you need to worry about. And there are four forces that we also need to worry about. The first you're very familiar with, gravity. All right, gravity is what keeps you in your seats, keeps us planted to the Earth, but also keeps the Earth in its rotation about the sun. Gravity. The second is what we're going to talk about this term, the electromagnetic force. And the electromagnetic force combines electricity, which you've heard about, and magnetism, which you've also heard about. But it's sort of a new idea to combine them. It's only 140 years old since Maxwell wrote down the equations for electromagnetism that we really combine those two separate things, electricity and magnetism. All right, the third is the strong nuclear force. This is the thing that holds the nucleus together, okay? It has to be strong because in the nucleus you have all these protons, and all those protons want to blow apart, okay? They want to separate from each other, and there's some force that holds them together, and that is the strong nuclear force. In fact, if you took a whole bunch of protons and put them in a nucleus, and now you hit that nucleus, you can in fact split it in two, and those two chunks of protons will separate very violently. So violently that they can knock into other atoms and split them in half as well. And this is of course what happens in the atomic bomb or in atomic energy, right? You get this nuclear fission, the nucleus fizzes into two. Okay, the strong nuclear force tries to hold it together, but if you get them far enough apart, they separate, the electromagnetic force kicks in, and they push apart very violently. And then the last thing is the weak nuclear force, and this has to do with radioactive decay. So last term we talked a lot about gravity. This term we are going to talk about electromagnetic forces and how charges behave in the presence of electromagnetic fields. All right, let's talk about this idea of charge. Charge is fundamental to understanding electromagnetism. And you already know a little bit about charge, probably, because you've taken chemistry classes. And one electron has a charge on it. One proton has a charge on it. A neutron turns out to have no charge on it, and that's where it's got its name, neutron, neutral. Okay? So one electron has a charge of negative 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. That's what this capital C is. It's a coulomb. A proton has exactly equal and opposite. 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs, positive. One neutron has a charge of zero. Okay, and this thing in right there, the capital C, that is called a coulomb. Okay, and that's a measure of charge. So one electron is a pretty small amount of coulombs. But we have a lot of electrons floating around, right? We got a lot of electrons, we have a lot of protons floating around. So, the rules for charges are the following, and it's really easy to remember. Likes repel, opposites attract. That's it. Likes repel, opposites attract. If I take two negative charges, and I put them next to each other in space, they repel. There is a force that is trying to push them apart. If I take a positive charge and a negative charge, there is attraction between them. There is a force trying to pull them together. Now, by Newton's third, you know that you have to have equal and opposite forces. So if I have F to the right on this one, I have to have F to the left on that one. And likewise down here, if I have F to the left on the negative charge, I have to have F to the right on the positive charge. Okay, equal and opposite forces. Now, this configuration right here might look a little familiar to you guys. Does anybody here know what that is? Sam, do you know what that is? Where might you find a positive charge and a negative charge right next to each other? I'll give you a hint. What are we made of? No, like in the universe, where might you find a positive charge and a negative charge? Right next to each other. What's that?
In atoms.
In atoms. Yeah. Exactly. This is an atom. Right here, okay? Let's talk about atoms. Atoms are very interesting because the whole universe is basically made up of atoms, right? There was a very famous physicist named Richard Feynman, and they asked him the following question. They said, if you could type a letter to an alien species telling them something about what we understand about the universe, but it was a Twitter-type message where you could only send one sentence, what would it be? Okay, and this is a Nobel Prize-winning physicist that they're asking this. So it's sort of an interesting thought experiment, right? If you could send one message to an alien, what would it be? And he said the following. Stuff is made of atoms. That would be his one sentence that he sent to this alien race, which I think is pretty cool, right? I mean, they might not know the word stuff, but you could put some other word there, right? They probably don't know English at all, but let's pretend that you had to say one thing and you could write it in binary code or whatever it was. Stuff is made of atoms. That is really powerful, okay? Because it tells you, oh, wait a minute. This human that's right here, there's something more complex happening inside it. And this solid right here, this table, there's something happening inside of it. And there's all these little things in there that are bound together. They are bound together by electromagnetic forces. That's what holds material together. This glass that I'm looking at you through, right? It has atoms in it. And those atoms are held together by electromagnetic forces. It turns out that it's transparent because visible light is not absorbed in those atoms. But other things are not transparent, right? My shirt is not transparent. It's made of atoms, but visible light is absorbed in that material. In this glass, visible light is not absorbed. So stuff is made of atoms. What are these atoms that we are talking about? Well, we said it just a second ago. It's a positive charge and a negative charge, and the negative charge is whirling around the positive charge. This is a very simple picture of the atom, but this is a great starting point for discussing the atom. If I think about the hydrogen atom has one proton in it. That's why it's number one on the periodic table. The electron is whirling around that proton. And in the ground state, it's more or less whirling around in a circle, okay? Now, when you get to quantum, it gets a little bit more complicated. You really can't talk about the electron having a specific position and going around like a point particle. It gets a little fuzzier because you have to invoke quantum and talk about the wave functions and things like that. But this is a great starting point for thinking about the atom. Now, if something is moving around in a circle, there has to be a force, right? We know that. Circular motion tells us that there must be a force that is keeping this thing moving in the circle. And when it was the Earth going around the Sun, it was gravity that was keeping that Earth in its orbit. But here it is, of course, a different force. It is the electromagnetic force. Likes repel, opposites attract. The electron is bound to the proton because this force that's holding it there. All right, so let's talk a little bit about the force, and let's introduce this idea of Coulomb's law. So Coulomb's law says the following. The force is K Q1 Q2 over R squared. K Q1 Q2 over R squared. What are these different things? K is a constant. It's Coulomb's constant. It is 8.9 times 10 to the 9, and then it's got some funky units on it, and you can sort of figure out what the units have to be, right? K is sitting up here. I got to end up with newtons, so there's got to be a newtons there. I got an R squared in the bottom. That's going to be a distance, so there must be a meters squared up in the top, and then I have Q1 and Q2, and we said the charge is in coulombs. So there must be coulombs squared in the bottom. Okay, this is Coulomb's constant. All right, there's some other digits there. You can add other digits if you want. It's like 8.998 or something. So we often say it's just 9 times 10 to the 9. What about Q1? Q1 is the charge of the first particle. Q2 is the charge of the second particle. And then finally, R is the distance between them. And here we're talking about Q1 and Q2, so it's the distance between those two charges, Q1 and Q2. Okay. This is Coulomb's law. This is a very powerful law, and it's going to apply to a great number of cases. Okay, we're going to talk about a lot of those this term. Later on, we'll see when this starts to break down, but for a great number of cases, this is really it. This is all you need. Okay, it starts to break down when we have to add magnetism, but we'll get to that later on. Let's write down Coulomb's law again. F equals K Q1 Q2 divided by R squared. Now, F is a force. Is a force a scalar or a vector? It's a vector, right? And so we need to put an arrow on top of that. And if there's an arrow on top of that, we'd better put some direction over here on the right side. And I like to just write it like that. Let's put an n hat right there. N hat is along the line from Q1 to Q2. And so you can decide if it's attractive or repulsive, but it's definitely going to be along the line between those two. All right. Let's see if we can figure out what that force is for a couple charges. Let's say we take the following. We had just talked about electrons and protons. Let's put them together and see what we get. Let's put an electron on the page. We'll put a proton on the page, and we will separate those two by a distance r. And let's figure out what the force is on the electron due to the proton. Okay, pretend the proton is nailed down to the page. It's not going to move around. The electron we put down there, and now we're going to see what's the force on the electron due to that proton. We know it's going to be attractive, so it's towards the proton. The strength is right here. It's KQ1, Q2 over R squared. Okay, but we know exactly what K is. We have that number. And we know what the charge of the proton is. It is 1E, which we write just like that. We know what the charge on the electron is. It's also an E, but it's negative. And then we have R squared in the bottom. Let's do this now and put in some real numbers. All right, so we have F equals negative K E squared divided by R squared. And let's say that we're going to let R equal 10 to the minus 10 meters. Okay, that's called an angstrom, 10 to the minus 10 meters. And let's put in some numbers and see what we get. So K, we said, was 8.988 times 10 to the 9. We're going to say that is 9 times 10 to the 9 in SI units. E is 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. We have to square that. And we're going to divide by R squared, which is 10 to the minus 10. And we're going to square that. So once you guys pull out your calculator or your phone and let's plug in some numbers, I will approximate it here. 9 times 1.6 is about probably 14. 14, and then I've got, oh, but we got to square that. Don't forget that. So 1.6 squared, that's about 3. So we've got a 9 times a 3, and then we've got a 10 to the 9. And then we have a 10 to the minus 19 squared, which is 10 to the minus 38. And then we're going to divide by 10 to the minus 10 squared, which is 10 to the minus 20. And so what do we get? We get 18 times 38 and 9. We have to add, so we get 10 to the minus 29. And we're going to divide by 10 to the minus 20. And so we get 18 times 10 to the minus 9, which is pretty close to 1.8 or 2 times 10 to the minus 10 newtons. That's my guess. What did you guys get? Did you get a real number? 2.3 times 10 to the negative 10. Okay. So that's a little bit more exact. Our guess was a little bit off, but that's okay. 2.3 times 10 to the minus 10 is the force in SI units, right? Newtons. for the electron and the proton at this separation. So that sounds like a small number, but electrons and protons are pretty small. Turns out this is the binding force of an electron to a proton in a hydrogen atom, roughly, okay? This is about the right distance between the proton and the electron in a hydrogen atom. It is about 1 angstrom, 10 to the minus 10 meters. So how hard is that electron held in its orbit? The force is that, okay? That's the force that is holding it in its orbit, 2.3 times 10 to the minus 10 newtons. All right, one other thing that we need to talk about right now is this idea that force is a vector. Force is a vector, and therefore Coulomb's law, we have to worry about adding those forces as vectors. F equals K, Q1, Q2, all over R squared, and then there is this direction associated with it. So let's try an example, and let's see if we can make maybe a simpler example than we had talked about earlier. Let's do the following. Let's say we draw a coordinate system here, X and Y, and let's do this. Let's put a charge, Q, right there. We'll put another charge, Q, right there, and then we'll put a third charge out here, equal distant away. And let's see if we can find the force on this charge due to the other two. Okay, very straightforward vector problem. Now let's give some dimensions here. We'll say that this distance here is L, and we will call that distance L and that distance L. So everything is L away from the origin. And now let's figure out what the force is on this little guy out here. Okay, we wrote down the force law, but what we had in there was an n hat. And the n hat says the direction is along the line between the two charges. So if this is the line, then the force on this guy has to be in that direction. We'll call that F1. The other guy is coming up like that, and so the force from it has to be along that line, F2. Let's just pretend they're all positive charges, okay? Three Qs, all of them greater than zero. All right, so now we just have to add up F1 and F2, and you know what's gonna happen. They're gonna add up to some F3 that is off in that direction. Okay, let's see if we can calculate what F3 is. All right, first off, let's take a look at, how about F2? F2 is the following. It is KQQ over R squared, and then there's gonna be some direction associated with it, okay? And we're not exactly sure how to write the direction yet, so let's make this the magnitude of F2, okay? That's what the magnitude of F2 is. It's KQQ over R squared. F3 is, of course, going to have the exact same magnitude, and that R squared is what? It's this. That's our R. But this is a right triangle. So R squared is in fact L squared plus L squared, which is 2L squared. And the same on F3. KQQ over 2L squared. All right, so those are the strengths of the two forces due to those guys. Okay, we're looking at the force on this one right here. But now we have to worry about the direction. Okay, let's think about the direction here. F2 is going up like that. And F2 therefore has some component in that direction and some component in that direction. And the components are the following. The horizontal is F2 cosine theta. The vertical is F2 sine theta. And likewise for F3, we're going to get something similar. F1 is just going down. And so for the two sides of that triangle, we would get F1 cosine theta and F1 sine theta. All right, and we know what theta is, right? If this is L and that's L, then we know that that's 45 degrees right there. That has to also be 45 degrees. And so now we're almost there because we have the magnitude. We're almost done with the direction, and we can figure out how to add this up. Okay, F2 as a vector is what? It is the magnitude of F2 cosine theta in the x direction, which we call I hat, plus F2 sine theta in the y direction, which we call J hat. And we know exactly what F2 is. It's KQQ over 2L squared. And then we have cosine of theta, I hat, plus KQQ over 2L squared times sine theta, J hat. F1, which we said is pointing down at an angle, that's going to be KQQ over 2L squared cosine theta, I hat. And then we have a sine on the other one, but it's pointing down, and so we need a minus sign. Minus KQQ over 2L squared sine theta J hat. And now what we're looking for is F3. F3 is equal to F1 plus F2. Well, here's F2. Here's F1. So F3 is F2 plus F1. And look what happens. If I add these up, these two are the same. These two are equal and opposite. And so the sine components, in fact, drop out entirely. And we just end up with this. And since we have two of them, we can double it, KQQ over L squared, the two in the bottom goes away, cosine theta, and the direction here is I hat. Okay. And if you want the magnitude of F3, then it's just the stuff that's out in front. Now in our example, we picked L and L, and so we also know that theta is going to be 45 degrees here, and 45 degrees, cosine of 45 degrees gets us a root 2 in the denominator. Okay, F3, that's your remaining force. It's this, KQQ over root 2 L squared, and it's in the x direction, I hat. If you want to calculate the magnitude of it, it's just that stuff out in front. Okay? So you kind of knew the answer, right? You knew that F3 had to be pointing to the right because those other two vectors were going to cancel in the vertical direction and they would contribute in the x direction, in the horizontal direction. All right, questions about this stuff? Feeling okay with it? All right, if that's not clear, definitely come see me in office hours. All right, why don't we try another charge example? But let's just do one dimension. Okay, let's say this is our XY coordinate system. Let's put one charge right here, Q1, right at the origin. We'll put Q3 right there. And let's put Q2 halfway in between. Okay, but let's give you some values. Let's say that Q1 is positive 5 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. And we'll say that Q3 is equal to negative 5 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. And let's ask the question, what is the force on number 2? Okay, what is the force on 2? And let's say that these distances are equal, and we will let L equal 10 microns, which is 10 to the minus 10, 10 times 10 to the minus 6 meters. Okay, that's 10 microns. All right, how do we do this? Well, we write down our force equation. Force equation is F equals K Q1 Q2 over R squared. And we remember that it's a vector, and so there is a direction associated with it. And now let's put our three charges right here. We've got Q1, we've got Q2, and we've got Q3. So there is a force on 2 due to 1, and we need one more piece of information here, right? We need to know what the charge is at Q2. So let's say that Q2 is equal to also 5 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. If I think about these charges now, this one is positive. Q1, we said, was positive. Q3 was negative. And we want the force on Q2 due to the other two. So the force on Q2 due to Q1, is it attractive or repulsive? Repulsive, because they are like charges. So Q1 is trying to push away Q2. But between Q2 and Q3, that's attractive, because Q3, we said, was negative. And so there's another force in that direction as well. So there's two forces acting on Q2. Both of them are to the right. And so what is the net force on F2? It's going to be F on 2 due to 1 plus F on 2 due to 3. And now we know exactly what those are. It's K, Q2, Q1, divided by L squared, right? We said the distance we called L. And then the other one is going to be minus K, Q2, Q3, divided by L squared. And the direction on both of those is to the right, which we're calling I hat. Now, why did I put a minus sign here? Right? We just said that both those forces are to the right. I put a minus sign there because Q3 is negative. So when I plug in a negative number here, it's going to cancel with that negative and give me a positive. All right, so let's try it with some of these numbers and see what we get. Okay, so let's calculate F2. We said that it is, well, it looks like we have some common factors here, right? We have a KQ2 over L squared, and then the first term is Q1, and the second term is negative Q3, all in the I-hat direction. And now we can put in all those numbers. K, we said, was 9 times 10 to the 9. Q2, we said, was 5 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. L, we said, was 10 microns, 10 times 10 to the minus 6 meters. And we got to square that. And then we have this quantity, which is Q1, 5 times 10 to the minus 19, minus Q3, which is negative 5 times 10 to the minus 19. Okay, so we have 5 minus a negative 5, and so that thing just doubles. And so what do we get? We get 9 times 10 to the 9, 5 times 10 to the minus 19. We have a 10 times 10 to the minus 6, which is a 10 to the minus 5. If I square that, I get a 10 to the minus 10 down there. And over here, I have a 5 plus a 5, so I have 10 times 10 to the minus 19. And now we can do this by hand, but you can double check on your calculator if you want. We've got 45 times 10 to the minus 10. That's a 10. And then we've got 10 to the minus 18. And we're going to divide by 10 to the minus 10. So the 10 to minus 10s drop out. And we get 4.5 times 10 to the minus 17. Yeah. So the question was about the 10 to the minus 19 here. What happened to that? And it became, let's see, the 9 times 5 got us a 45. And then we had a 10 to the 9 and a 10 to the minus 19. So that became a 10 to the minus 10.
And then the next one over
here? And then this one right here, 10 times 10 to the minus 19. The 10 means I have to add 1 to the exponent. And so adding 1 to minus 19 becomes minus 18. Right? Are we okay? All right, good. I think that's right. Good. So we've got 4.5 times 10 to the minus 17 newtons. Okay? That would be the force on Q2 due to those other two charges. All right, which sounds like a small number, but it's because we'd use charges that were sort of 5 electrons or 5 protons big, and yet the distances were large compared to atomic distances, right? 10 microns is much, much bigger than 10 angstroms. Okay, any questions about that one? Everybody feeling all right? Okay, good. But let's complicate it a little bit. Let's say we do the following. Let's say I take a positive charge and I take a negative charge and I put them reasonably close to each other. What should the net electric field look like for those two charges? Okay, this is a popular term called a dipole. Two poles, positive and negative. And now let's see if we can figure out what the electric field should look like. All right, you might think, well, we can draw this field. And we can draw the field for the negative charge. And we should be done. But that's not quite right. And why is it not quite right? Because these field lines really extend forever. Okay, we can draw another one and another one and another one, and it gets smaller as it goes out, of course, but they go on forever. The positive one goes on forever and just gets shorter as you go. And so you look at these two and you say, well, that's got to be the field lines. But when we draw electric fields, we need to draw the net electric field. And electric fields are vectors, and so we have to add them up according to our vector rules. So at this point right here, we have two vectors, one going down to the left, one going down to the right, but we need to figure out what the net electric field is. What's the net vector sum of those two? And so this picture isn't quite right. And so let's draw it again, but let's draw the correct picture. Okay, there's my plus and minus charge. I obviously am going to have one electric field line that goes straight down from the top one to the bottom one. There's going to be another one that comes out of the positive, but that's going to go into the negative. And somehow I have to join these two lines. You might think it just goes straight out and then makes a kink and then it goes down. But physics never behaves that way, right? Physics is smooth. And so the curve has to be smooth. And so it looks like that. And there's one on the other side that looks like that. And then there's another one here that looks like this. And another one there that looks like that. And another one there that looks like that. And so forth. Okay, and they keep coming out of the top and eventually going into the bottom. And now we've drawn vector fields that look a little different than we had before, right? We had a whole bunch of arrows before, but now I have a bunch of lines. This is an equivalent way of drawing electric fields. The strength of the electric field has to do with the density of the lines. If the lines are close together, the field is strong. If the lines are far apart from each other, they're very weak. So this is another representation of the dipole field. Okay. Dipole fields are really important because atoms are made up of positive charges and negative charges. Molecules, polar molecules like water, will have a negative end and a positive end. And so the fields that surround them are dipole fields. And that explains how those things, those atoms and molecules, are going to interact with other atoms and molecules that are nearby. How are those different molecules going to combine to form new compounds? It's because of the interaction of the dipole field between the two. So understanding this picture is really important. Now, when you think about positive and negative charges, and you talk about field lines, what you can say is field lines originate on positive charges and they terminate on negative charges. And this is often referred to as the source and the sink of the electric field. Positive charges are the sources, negative charges are the sinks. Let's talk about a solid sphere of charge. And let's think about the electric field from this solid sphere of charge. So I'm going to take, let's say, a whole bunch of positive charges and put them everywhere here in the sphere. Okay, and it's solid. What is the electric field outside the sphere? What direction do you think it is? Sam, what do you think? Probably doing this. Yeah, I'd say that's fine. Okay. It looks like it was a point charge, right? Everything concentrated at the center, stuff is going uniformly outward. Okay, that's the electric field outside this sphere. What about the electric field inside the sphere? If it's uniformly charged everywhere, then inside the sphere, we're going to have the following. Right at the center, E equals zero. But as soon as you go out from the center, it starts to go radial again, and it increases its strength as you go out. Okay, this is a solid sphere of charge, charge everywhere distributed throughout the sphere. Now let's take a look at a different example which is a hollow shell of charge. Okay, if I think about a hollow shell, here it is. I'm just going to put charge all the way around the outside. And if I put charge all the way around the outside, what do you think the electric field looks like on the outside? Catherine, what do you think? Which way should I draw my electric field on the outside of this hollow shell? Yeah, she said, shouldn't it still be going up here and away from the charges there, right? Radiate outward. It should look very similar to that. And that is exactly right. It's always pointing radially out from the sphere. But here's the $64,000 question. Alina, what is the electric field inside the hollow shell of charge? Okay. Why do you think it's going in towards the center? Because all these are positive, and so it's got to be going away from those positives? Is that why? Okay. So her hypothesis is the sources are all around the edge, and so the electric field has to be going away from those sources, right? I think that's a great hypothesis, except there is something very unique about a sphere. A sphere of uniform charge, in fact, has electric field equal to zero, not just in the center, but anywhere inside. Okay, E is equal to zero inside. Whereas over here, other than the exact center, E was not equal to zero. Okay, and this is sort of a weird thing, but it's this idea that, all right, I might be closer to this charge over here, but there's a lot more charge on the other side of me. Yes, I'm closer to this one, but there's more charge over here, and it just exactly balances out such that E is everywhere zero inside the hollow sphere. Okay, this is a very subtle point, and we can prove it using something called Gauss's law, which is a slightly tricky concept, but one that we will get to. Electric fields, just like forces, are vectors. We have to add them according to our vector rules. So let's say we have the following. Let's say we have a positive charge sitting right there. We have a positive charge sitting right there. And we're going to look for the electric field at this location right here. How do I figure out E at this location? Well, they're vectors. So the electric field from this one is going to come out radially, which means up here it's going to be pointed in that direction. The electric field from the other one is also radial from its center, and so it will be pointing down in that direction. And now if I add two vectors like that, I know what they have to be. It has to be all to the right. They're going to cancel out vertically. They're going to contribute horizontally, and you get a net electric field that is in that direction. So just looking at this picture, you can identify a few things right off the bat. For instance, if I am right here, halfway in between those two charges, what's the electric field? What's the net electric field right there? Sam, you said it, zero, right? It's got to be zero because the top one is pushing down, the bottom one's pushing up, those electric fields perfectly cancel, and you get a net electric field of zero. If I'm over here, I have the exact same problem as this, just on the other side, and so I'm going to get something going to the left. Okay, so that is adding these electric fields. You have to be careful and make sure that you regard them as vectors. Okay, so what is the strength of these electric fields? Well, the strength is the following. What we said was E is F over Q naught. The magnitude is just going to be the magnitude of F divided by Q naught. And here, F is Coulomb's law. So it is K times Q naught divided by R squared. And all of that is going to be divided by Q naught. And so the Q naughts cancel out, and we get K Q over R squared. This is the magnitude of the electric field, and if you want to write it back as a vector, you can say this, KQ over R squared, R hat. Okay, and R hat is the direction, and it's radial from the charge Q. So here's my charge Q, capital Q. Okay, let's say it's positive. And let's calculate the strength of the electric field here. Well, we know what the electric field looks like. It's pointing radially outward. It drops off like 1 over R squared, so these arrows get a little bit shorter as you go out. And you can draw as many as you like. Now, let's say I want to calculate the electric field a distance r away from the center. I drew a point here where there's no arrows. Does that mean there's no electric field there? No, of course not. The electric field is everywhere out here. We just don't want to draw an infinite number of arrows. So the electric field at this point still exists. And that electric field is going to be K times the charge, which we said was capital Q, divided by R squared, and the direction is R hat radially outward. So we draw with an arrow right there. Gets weaker as you go out because it falls off like 1 over R squared. The direction is always away from the point charge, and it has a strength that increases with the amount of charge, capital Q. So Sam's asking about the atoms that we're all made of and the forces that are holding the atoms together. And what we said is that it is the electromagnetic force, right? Here's the proton, here's the electron. There's some force there, which is the electromagnetic force. Yes?
So since I'm made of atoms and the table is made of atoms, is that a force between me and the table, like electromagnetic force too? Between my atoms, you know, and the table's atoms, or my protons and the table's electrons?
Okay. Okay, so his question is there a force between him and the other objects in the room that are made up of atoms? Okay? And that's a really good question, right? Let's think about that for a second. When I write this, right, a proton and electron, okay, this isn't quite to scale, right? Proton and electron are a little bit smaller, a little bit closer together. So really, a proton and electron look like this. Here's the proton, here's the electron, right next to it, okay? If I think about the electric field out here at some point, right there. What does the electric field do to those two charges? Probably small, probably nearly zero. Why is it zero? Because the plus has an electric field that goes like that. But the minus, which is sitting nearly in the same place, has an electric field that looks like that. So everywhere they're equal and opposite, and so they almost cancel out, okay? And so you don't feel a force between you and the table or you and something else. But you do if you get close enough. Okay, when I go like this, what happened? What happened, Sam? When I just did that, what happened? Okay, but what do you see right here? Can you see that in front of you? Yeah, what is that? Okay, it's ink that was on me, right? And some oil from my hand that I left on the glass. And if you look really closely here, you can see my fingerprint, right? Maybe the resolution on the camera is not good enough, but zoom in on your laptop. Maybe you can see my fingerprint right there. Yeah, you can. Okay. What happened was the stuff on my hand got close enough to the glass that it started to distinguish between the positives and the negatives, and it did feel a force. And in fact, it felt so much of a force that it left my hand and stuck to the glass. Okay? That's exactly what happened. So let's try an example. And let's do an electric field example. And let's do the following. We're going to take four charges, Q1, Q2, Q3, and Q4, and let's calculate the force right at the center of this square. So this side is L, this side is L. And we're going to figure out, not the force, I'm sorry, the electric field right at the center of the square. And let's give you some values here for the Qs. Q1 is going to be the same as Q2 and Q3, which is 2.4 times 10 to the minus 12 coulombs. Q4 is going to be negative 2.4 times 10 to the minus 12 coulombs. Okay. And let's see if we can calculate E right at the center of this configuration. And we'll say that the length of each side is 4 centimeters. All right. So, how can we do this? Well, electric fields are vectors. Vectors obey the principle of superposition, which means we can add them up according to the vector rules. So if we want to calculate E at the center, we could calculate E due to number 1, E due to number 2, E due to number 3, and E due to number 4, and just add them up. Okay? So let's draw it again right here. Here's our square. Here we are at the center. This was Q1. This was Q2, Q3, and Q4. Let's think about Q1 for a second. At this position right here, what direction is the electric field from Q1? It has to be along the line between the two. And Q1 was a positive charge, right? We said that was positive. Positive means the electric field is going to point away from it. So that is E1. That's the electric field from Q1. Q2 is also positive. And the electric field from Q2 is going to point that way. E2. Q3 is also positive, and so the electric field from it is going to point radially away from it. So it's going to be right there. And then finally, Q4 is a negative. And so the electric field from Q4 is going to point towards it, in the same direction as E1. So look what happens. E1 and E3, I'm sorry, not E1 and E3, E2 and E3 are equal and opposite. They cancel. Right? E2 is pointing up to the right, E3 is down to the left, and so those two exactly cancel out. E1 and E4 are in the same direction with the exact same strength, in fact, and so they add up. Okay? And so now the problem is really simple. All we have to do is calculate the electric field due to one of them and double it. All right, let's do it. What is E total? It's just twice E1. And we know what E1 is. It's KQ1 divided by this distance R squared. Okay, and we know K. K is 9 times 10 to the 9. We know Q1. It's 2.4 times 10 to the minus 12. That's staying on the board. Yeah, that's all right. And then we got to divide by R squared. Now we have to be a little bit careful about R here because this side of the triangle is in fact L over 2. That side of the triangle is also L over 2. So R squared is in fact L over 2 squared plus L over 2 squared. And so we get 2 times L over 2 squared. Right? L over 2 squared plus L over 2 squared equals R squared. And we know that number now. So now we can plug all this in to your calculator. Why don't you try it and tell me what you get? Okay, we've got L, we said was 4 centimeters. So 4 centimeters there is 0.04, but we're going to divide it by 2, so that's 0.02. We're going to square that, and then we have a 2 out in front of it. Well, that's convenient, because that 2 is going to cancel with that 2. And so I will approximate it here, and you guys can tell me what you get. 9 times 2.4 is 18, 23-ish, 23 times 10 to the minus 3. And then we've got a 2 times 10 to the minus 2 squared, which is 4 times 10 to the minus 4. And that, I'm going to say, is 23 over 4 is pretty close to 6 times 10 to the 1. So we're going to say it is 60 newtons. Is that close to what people got? Or not even close?
I got 54.
You got 54? All right, so we're pretty close. 54 newtons. I'm sorry. It's not newtons, right? We're calculating electric field. Electric field is volts per meter. That's the SI unit, volts per meter. Okay? That's the value of the electric field right in the center. Okay? And we took advantage of some real important things here. We took advantage of this notion of superposition, adding up electric fields according to the vector rules. And that greatly simplified the problem because two of them canceled and the other two doubled. Okay, and then the rest was just plugging in some of the numbers. All right, any other questions about that one? You guys feeling okay? All right, hopefully that's clear. If not, definitely come see me in office hours. Cheers. Mm-hmm.